Yeah, see, that's my other computer is hardwired in, and that one's not even coming up right now because
Okay. All right, ma'am. Well, we'll be good. We just went live. Hello, everybody. Sorry for those few technical difficulties. We are getting started here. We'll do the best that we can. But I'm Tom Murray, the State and District Digital Learning Director at the Alliance for Excellent Education in Washington, D.C., and one of the leaders of the Future Ready Schools effort. Future Ready Schools is a project of the Alliance for Excellent Education in collaboration with the U.S. Department of Education, as well as a vast coalition of over 40 national organizations. The goal of Future Ready Schools is to maximize digital learning opportunities to help school districts move quickly towards preparing students for success in college, a career, and citizenship. The effort provides districts with resources and support to ensure that local technology and digital learning plans aligned with instructional best practices are implemented by highly trained teachers and lead to personalized learning experiences for all students, particularly those from traditionally underserved communities. The hashtag for today's webinar is Future Ready. Thank you for making an investment and joining us today. I'm your host on this webinar about transforming learning spaces. With me today is Superintendent of the Year, recently named in Virginia, and congratulations, the incredibly dynamic and fun leader from Virginia, Pam Moran. So what an honor it is to have you today, Pam. Glad we got some technical issues cleared up, and hopefully you're able to stick with us throughout the course of the webinar. And sorry for those Virginia internet issues today. But it's great to have you here. Take a few minutes to introduce yourself.
Hey, Tom, I tell you what would it be without at least one tech glitch as we're trying to get all the schools in the United States future ready? But, you know, that is part of what comes with the turf of trying to get everybody to a place where we really are up and able to run with just a turn of the key. And I think that whether it's working with our local service provider or working to try to make sure that all of our schools are places where children can get access easily and constantly, that we have some challenges in the country. And I'm really glad that we've got the Alliance as a key leader in trying to make that happen. I'm a superintendent in Central Virginia, and I've been in this job for 10 years. And one of the things that I'm most proud of is the fact that I work with what I would describe as one of the most innovative, cutting-edge, forward-thinking groups of educators that you can find anywhere in the United States of America, and in my opinion, probably the world. And I just, my hat's off every day to the work that our educators are doing out in the field to really make sure that our kids are getting the kind of learning that they need in order to be ready for their future.
Yeah, well, a dynamic leader like yourself often does just that, passes all the pats on the back to the people that work alongside them every day. But I will certainly say it's your leadership that's been recognized nationwide, so we're glad to have you here today. Thanks for that quick intro. Well, today's topic is on learning spaces. And when I think nationwide about what's going on with learning spaces and starting to see this transformation, you know, when we go nationwide, we often still see the very teacher-centric environment with desks in rows, students facing forward, teacher front and center. But when I think of your district, I know you guys have been at this for a while now, because the notion of redesigning learning spaces has really become a hot topic in the past few years. And in Albemarle County Schools, you've been at it for a while now. Why did you see the need to transform these spaces starting a few years ago?
Well, I think that, Tom, that one of the things that as I became really much more aware of that we were seeing a world change around schools, and schools are for the most part very insulated spaces where people come to work every day. I had a kindergarten teacher say to me one time after she retired, she said, "Oh gosh, I never knew that there was a world outside the box." And I think that that's one of the things that education has very purposefully really tried to create a very protected environment to allow teachers to do their jobs, to allow children to come to school, be safe, engage in learning, and go home. But one of the things that I think that also does is it really insulates us from the radical changes that occur sometimes outside of school. And the one that really I think has caught my attention is that certainly over the last 20 to 30 years, that as technology has become more omnipresent in our lives in terms of the changes it's wrought in our homes, in our communities, and especially in the workplace, that schools have been a place that has not necessarily seen that the way that we're working to educate kids needed to shift in response to those changes. But I also think that the other thing is that the whole standards-driven movement that has started in the 90s really started to create a situation where rather than seeing our children as individuals, people who personally have an investment in their learning, that we really did, I think, take the whole level of factory modeling in our schools in the 20th century to a whole new level in the early part of the 21st century. And so I'm really pleased to see that as of yesterday that ESSA is looking like it's going to move forward. I know in Virginia we've got an innovation committee for education that's working front and center at the state level to make some changes there. But I think that what I realized is that we had to be more responsive, and that if you wanted to change the kind of learning that kids do, that if you sustain the same kind of environment, the same kind of learning place, classrooms and schools that we had always had, that it was going to be exceedingly difficult for teachers and kids to work differently. So we started to look at what would space look like that supported kids who really were children that were using technology in really powerful ways as creators, not just consumers. What would it look like if our kids were involved in project-based learning that used old and new technologies to really pursue the kind of problem-solving and communication that we really think is critically important for kids to do? What does it look like if teachers really move away from the dominant teaching wall and become more facilitators of learning? Not that there aren't times when it's important for teachers to sit down and really do some direct kind of work with kids, but how do we create an environment that allows our kids to be much more connected with learning in an engaged, highly agent way? And that was going to demand that the space needed to look different than desk and rows with one dominant teaching wall in the classroom.
You know what I just loved about that response and talking about the why is I think you probably said the word kid 20 times in that response, and it just shows the type of kid-centered environment you're really looking to create. So in talking about these new learning spaces, what are the types of spaces that you're designing now, and what are some of the keys? What are the characteristics you're looking for?
Well, I will tell you that we really are focusing on our schools taking a look at every space that exists inside the schools as well as outside the schools. So we're looking at the grounds of our schools. We're also looking at the community and saying that when we think about that learning in the 20th century was more place-bound, how do we become sort of space agnostic and see whether it's virtually, whether it's face-to-face, whether it's in the community, whether it's inside a classroom, whether it's in a hallway, how does every space that we can envision, sort of the 4D world, really support children as learners? And so, you know, our libraries have been through a process, and they are still in some different stages. Different ones are much farther ahead, and others are moving along the continuum of moving from what I call the old model that's really the Gutenberg model of, you know, we write something, we print it, people read it, they're expected to recall it and carry it around in their heads, to what I call the search, connect, communicate, and make model that really, I think, represents more of sort of the natural learning in which people have engaged since probably there were first opportunities for people to see themselves as learners. And that is the idea that people are always curious about and seeking new information, new knowledge, new competencies and skills. It's part of what we do as humans. So our libraries and our schools really are places where we want our kids to be curious, seeking, and thoughtful learners who are going after things not just that we think are important for them to learn, but also things they're really interested in learning. We see the whole idea of connectivity as being something that's about the spaces that we build, whether it's a gym that looks more like a fitness center today and less like an old-style 20th century gym, so that kids really have more of a sense of agency over their own health and well-being. We look at one of the things that we discovered in recent years in our high schools is our high school kids don't use lockers anymore. You know, we've got anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000 kids in our comprehensive high schools with lockers for every one of them, and we found that in our biggest high school, we only had 30 students who were using lockers. Imagine that. So one of the initiatives that we've embarked on in the last 3 or 4 years is we're taking lockers out and building informal learning areas, more like you might see in a college or university setting, where kids can gather around for study groups or conversation or just to socialize. So we have created spaces in our halls where we've pulled hallway lockers, and we've put in charging bars and places where teachers can use whiteboards out in the halls with kids, or kids can go out in small groups and work. And so one of the things that we're saying is hallways, cafeterias, libraries have often been places that have been really underutilized, And how are we able to make each of those spaces places that serve in different ways for kids to be able to see themselves as learners, as well as for teachers to be able to do a lot of different things with them? One of the biggest innovations that we've, and it's kind of a back to the past, you know, there are a number of younger generation educators who were educated in more open space classrooms back in the 70s that are now teaching in our schools today. And there are people that see that as a failed experiment. But one of the things that we said is, like, with all good mistakes, if you take the best of the idea that led to the mistake and you try to figure out why it didn't work, what would you do to improve upon it, innovate it, and try to see what would make it be something that would work better? Well, one of the things that we've just done is we've just opened a flex space environment for 120 children in K-5 that's totally open, but open in a really different way. It has really great acoustical materials. It's got ways that teachers can, when they need to create more cave spaces or more small group spaces, they can close things down, they can open things up widely, but it's allowing our kids to work in those natural multi-age communities that are much more representative of the way people learn in the real world. Nobody goes to work with everybody that's all 24 years old. Nobody goes to work with everybody that's all 45 years old. And yet we expect our kids to be able to work totally in grade-banded environments in our elementary schools. And one of the things that we're finding is that we've unleashed kids in that multi-age environment in ways that are profoundly different, but we've also addressed some of the big errors that caused those open space multi-age opportunities to fail in the 1970s. So, you know, one of the things we're always doing is saying, you don't just always throw out the baby with the bathwater. There have been great ideas in education for a very long time. How is it that we really try to capitalize on the best of what we know about how people learn and learn well, and be able to create the spaces to allow those things to happen?
Yeah, really well said. This past week, just the other day, I was with my good friend that you know well as well, Superintendent Daryl Adams out in Coachella Valley, and you're talking about spaces. And, you know, Daryl is in a place where it's 100% free and reduced lunch, literally every 98% Latino in one of the poorest areas of the community. And, you know, you're talking about all these innovative spaces, and they had that need for connectivity as well. And so, you know, our viewers may be aware, but what they did in Coachella Valley is they put Wi-Fi on their buses because a lot of their kids also had longer commutes, where they were able to then gain connectivity to and from school. That's a learning space. That becomes what typically used to be, we're just kind of hanging out downtime. Now kids are doing work. They're being able to be connected. Yeah. But he then also brought the learning space to the community and is starting to park those buses inside of the poorest areas of their community, near some of the trailer parks, near the HUD housing, so that kids can go on throughout the night and be able to do that. Now, I also know at where you are, you guys have done incredible partnerships with the community and connectivity as well. Can you talk a little about some of your community work and has
absolutely, yeah,
how this has evolved, how you're keeping the community up to date?
Well, I will tell you that Daryl is a real inspiration, I think, to superintendents across the country that are in urban areas where there are real challenges. Because one of the things that we know is that our kids, you know, that we talk about our computers being portable, but computers are only portable because people can move the computers. And so one of the things that we know is that our kids, they like to work in a lot of places. And, you know, they like to be able to go to a coffee shop. They like to be able to work outside. They like to be able to work in their own homes. They like to get together at their friends' houses to work on projects. You know, and one of the things that we talk about is that, you know, we used to, you know, that euphemism of, you know, 24/7 learner. And at the time when that first started to get bandied around a little bit, there really were very few kids that were in situations where you would call them 24/7 learners. But today, you know, kids just don't see the boundaries of a classroom or a school or even a school district as being the limiters that, you know, existed in my childhood or in my even my son's childhood. He's 28, but it's a different world today than it was even when he was growing up. So one of the things that we realize in a school division in a county that has 726 square miles, 95% rural, that stretches from the Blue Ridge Mountains to the Piedmont of Virginia, is that we have a lot of kids living in areas where internet access, the density of the populations is much less. We have kids that are living in low-income housing in our urban ring that are sometimes challenged to be able to get access. And we said, we know that service providers are not going to be the full solution to be able to get families the access they need so that their kids can do the work. that they want to be able to do, whether it's their own personal learning or whether it's work that they're doing around work for school. So we've really done something pretty unique. We have taken back our educational broadband service that used to be leased, and we went to the FCC. We had to prove to them that we could actually set up our own wireless networks across our school division. And we went through the proof of concept, and we are now building out our own wireless network. We're also laying our own dark fiber cable in areas that are more urban, with the idea that we don't want either a family's financial situation or the distance that they are from the capability to get good internet connectivity to be a limiter in their lives. So we're planning to light up our entire community and are doing that right now. We've started that work. We've got great results, and our hope is that in 3 years there would be no child in any family situation in our community where they can't get to the internet to do the work that they want to do, and maybe even involve their families in some of the learning work. You know, I think about, you know, we have kids that, you know, walk into our community that are coming from all over the world, and our ELL learners, and oftentimes their families are trying to participate in adult education. How is it that being able to access Albemarle County Public Schools network opens the door for them as a family to be able to access education? And why wouldn't we want to make that available when we know we can? And so I think that my hat's off to Vince Shriver. He's our chief technology officer, and Vince is a genius in figuring out how to do this. And it's changed the way we think about what learning can be for kids and what our community can be in terms of a place where anybody, anytime can see themselves as a learner. So that is a place that we're going, and it's, you know, slow going at times because we are 726 square miles. I laughed when I was up at the New York Maker Faire, the World Maker Faire at the New York Hall of Science. I said to the group there, I come from a community that's twice the size of New York City geographically. And so, you know, that's who we are.
Yeah, no, that's great. And, you know, that's been coined the homework gap. I wish it was called the connectivity gap, because it's not about homework, it's about connectivity. You've certainly been a leader in that field. And I know the Pew Research had come out and said about 5 or 6 million of our, I want to say 26 million families in the nation with children, school-age children, do not have connectivity. It's about 17 or 18% nationwide. And part of the mission and vision related to Future Ready is really serving those that are underserved. And part of that percentage is very highly populated by our Black and Hispanic families. And so really meeting those needs, especially for those children that are traditionally underserved, is really important. But getting back to the redesign piece, you know, where you're thinking about spaces much more than your traditional 800 square foot classroom that's been built over and over and over again. Right. You know, we're talking buses, we're talking community, flexible spaces and outside, but bringing it back into the building, something that I know you're good at, is that student and teacher voice side of things. And I know when these spaces are being thought out and planned out, because you don't do this stuff overnight, some of that planning really goes into that. You know, where are we with things? But captivating student voice, teacher voice, and their thoughts is really a big part of this process. So where does that fit when it comes to you guys redesigning spaces?
Well, we really see our kids as being a part of both the visioning and then also the revision process. In many ways, designing a space is very much like the writing process. So you draft it, and you redraft it, and you edit it, and eventually you get it pretty close to being something that's publishable. And I think that our music construction studios and our libraries are an example of that. And I'll tell you the other thing that I think is a pretty important point about Albemarle, Tom, that may differentiate in some ways from some other places, is that I have a real belief. I believe in the concept that Deborah Fries and Margaret Wheatley advanced in a book called Walk Out, Walk On, where they said the effort to scale up with the idea of just replicating what somebody else has done really is one of the big killers of innovation. And so we tend to talk about what are the big ideas that we believe really make a difference for young people, and how do we scale those across our schools versus trying to pick up an idea that somebody's done really well in one school and just take it to the other school and say, okay, here's your box, now you make this work, just like that school did. Our music construction studios are a great example of that. And our first school that built out the high school learning commons model in the library and actually was the National School Board Association Magna Award winner this past year for their work, One of the things that they've really done is to create this amazing space in the library. They've got a hacker space, they've got poetry cafes, they've got design studios, they've got reading labs, they've got genius bars, and sound studios. Pretty much it is one of those spaces when you go in there, you know, you realize that the library is bringing kids in ways that they never have come before. In fact, one of the things we had to deal with are kids that were actually skipping class to go to the library, and so we had to figure out how to have class be just as enticing as the library had become. And so anyway, in that sound construction studio, you've got kids in there who are cutting across all the boundaries of groups that you have in high schools. You've got the jocks, you've got the high academics, you've got the kids that really love to do hands-on learning, you've got kids of different, you know, ethnicities and races and socioeconomic levels, all who have one thing they share in common, and that is a love of making music and making their own music. And so Monticello High School built that concept out, and, you know, one of the most fun moments I ever had was when I bought the first tune that kids had written and put up on iTunes and had it loaded on my phone, and I played it for the two kids that had written the tune, and they were just like just ecstatic that I had actually bought their iTunes, that they had up or had bought their music off of the iTunes store. And they pretty quickly made their money back in terms of starting to build this album. But then we had another high school say, hey, that's pretty cool. They went and visited, and they came back. We invested a very little bit of money, you know, because we're a pretty much a DIY, a, you know, do-it-yourself kind of environment, because we don't have a lot of money. We've got, capital improvements are a real challenge for us. We took down a little bit of a wall, created a glass window so people could see in this room, put some secondhand music equipment in it just to get the kids started. And the kids came in and started having ideas about how could we soundproof this? What could we do to create a really comfortable environment? Who's got furniture that maybe is sitting around in a house or knows somebody that might know somebody that could donate stuff? They painted it from scratch. The kids picked out what they wanted to do with the walls. They've built the equipment. They have set it up. And now they've got their own studio that doesn't look anyone like at Albemarle High School, doesn't look like the one at Monticello High School. Now our third high school, Western Albemarle, has gone through a similar shift, and their studio is evolving. But again, it's different, and the context of what the kids want to do there is a little different. And so one of the things that we try to do is to be responsive to what we hear from our kids in terms of their voice about what they think is important to actually accomplish. Probably the most perfect example of the last couple of months has been, you know, there's a lot of people around the country that have caught the buzz of this big XQ project out of Laureen Jobs, out of the Jobs Foundation. And so we've got a team that's putting together a proposal to put in. But we paired up with Student Voice over at the University of Virginia. And one of the things that we've had the college kids doing is going out and asking kids, and we didn't just say, let's go to our high school kids, because quite frankly, the high school kids will be gone probably before we're able to make a radical change. If, you know, we've said whether we get the money or not, we're going to do a lot of the work we're trying to outline. We actually had them go talk to children as young as kindergartners about what they would love to see happen for them as they grow up inside school. And so one of the things that we've done, whether it's strategic planning, whether it's advisory groups, we always are trying to go back to our kids and say, what do you think about how we could do this project? What are the things you want to work on? What are the things that you think would make this better? Perfect example was we had a young woman at the high school conference at the White House recently who went to her teacher and said, you know, she's in a science academy, a STEM academy, and she said, I think that our middle school girls don't really understand this whole engineering thing. I'd like to do something for middle school girls to really have them understand how much fun engineering is, how much fun math is. And so the teacher said, what do you want to do? And she said, I'd like to have them learn how to do bridge building. So she goes out, she figures out how to put this together, and puts together a summer camp for middle school girls last summer, which she and some friends put together, hauled a bunch of equipment down in the woods, and literally built a bridge with these middle school girls who had done the design thinking work around that and the engineering work on the Ravanna Trail, which is a running, walking nature trail that runs around the county but still has need for some improvements. So these girls did go down and they build a bridge over a creek. And I like to think about that idea that our kids are growing themselves as people who believe in social good and know how to have agency as a result of us kind of unleashing them. And so the woods literally became the learning space for that camp last summer, along with the school environment where the kids were learning some of the work before they went out there. Those are concrete examples that happen all the time. We have a group called Team 19. Here's another example of a learning space modification. High school principal said, our teachers are really frustrated because we have ninth graders that come in every year that are just disenchanted with school. They've been kind of terminally in remediation. And we work really hard to get them to graduate, and we get them there. We have a 2.3% dropout rate countywide, and that is so much better than it was just 10 years ago. But we still say every kid counts. We don't want any kid not walking across the stage. So he wanted to work on something that would really get kids out of the remediation path. And what we ended up doing, that group of teachers working with, thinking about how could they get out of the box, decided they would take four classrooms in this school, turn them into two classrooms, and build a co-teaching interdisciplinary model, unbind the time so that we're not on a bell schedule with this group of kids. And so we prototyped a model in which these kids are getting an enriched user experience that looks substantively different than the typical high school. And these kids are coming to school every day. Their attendance is great. Their discipline is non-existent in terms of issues. They are doing more high-powered learning. I had somebody that was on a tour with me that said, so is this a gifted classroom? And I thought, you know, that's what we've set out to accomplish, is how do we see the gifts in every child? And yet, this doesn't look like your typical high school environment took walls down to build it. These kids just, if you were looking in my Twitter feed of the last week, one of the things that's been kicking up is these kids were given in teams $10 to design a water filtration system that would be something that could be built on the cheap, and maybe it could be used in a natural disaster or third world countries where water filtration is a real challenge. And so these kids, you know, with the constraint of you've only got 10 bucks, have built these amazing water filtration systems, and they've been testing them all week to see who's getting the best quality of water running through these systems they've built. How cool is that? You know, and the teachers will tell you, being able to be in the same space together changes the game for them. Not having to jump up and stop work when the bell rings has changed the game for them. And taking away the concept of seat time is what gets you to the end of a course has really been something pretty remarkable, because these kids are going to get 5 credits for what essentially would be worth 4 credits in any given year, because we're giving them a CTE credit for their sound and media work that they're doing as a part of their projects this year. So, you know, you got, if you start to think about that idea that teachers have traditionally lived in boxes where they get there early, they oftentimes leave late, they don't get a chance to get out and see the world, when you start to have people connect, it changes the way we think. When people start to cross-pollinate, and you know, I think we probably have close to 50% or more of our teachers out in social media, they are making connections with people all over the world, with people in their own schools, and people across our school district. And as they cross-pollinate, it frees them to think about the fact that none of us are really in the box unless we choose to be. Last summer, I laugh about that, some of the cheapest consulting work that I've ever had done was done by a kindergarten teacher who, during the month of July, offered several workshops for teachers on how to use social learning media in the classroom. And she brought with her 5 consultants who were rising first graders. And it was just fabulous to walk in and see these little kids. They were in a middle school, and they had to literally stand on the science cabinets for people to be able to see them. And they're showing, you know, the map of the world and all the places that they Skyped with and what they learned from Skyping with kids in other countries, with experts who brought different things to them, to their classroom. They talked about Twitter and how much fun that they had being able to put questions up on Twitter or learn from Wonderopolis, you know, and which is, they followed on Twitter. And I walked away and I said, for the price of an ice cream cone, we got some of the best learning work that we've had in terms of teachers working with consultants to learn about social media. So one of the things I think about is that really, think about what those five and 6 year olds took away from the experience of seeing themselves as teachers and a whole classroom of teachers seeing themselves as learners. So, you know, I have a teacher that has a sign up, used to have a sign up over a room, and it said, in this classroom, everybody is a teacher and everybody is a learner. And I like to think that that's what agency is all about, is that teachers remaining learners for a lifetime. And around, you know, we've had teachers that have probably taught for 30 years in a dominant teaching wall classroom, who now you walk in and they've got kids that you may see, four or five kids sitting on the floor working on a project, kids working at the wall, kids working, you know, with desks pulled up, maybe a couple of kids on a couch, who have really said everything changes when kids start to really own their learning. And the only way kids can really own it in an active way is to engage them actively. And space makes a difference in that.
Yeah, so well said there. And you really, what's really come out of your conversation here today is so much of how the shift in teaching is occurring compared to that very teacher-centric environment. Really one of the mm-hmm. cores of why redesign anyway, and that, how it goes hand in hand with the redesign of the learning space, as with how teaching and learning is being redesigned there as well. One of the things you started to hit, though, on was budget. And I know in some of the work that I've done in learning spaces, that question always comes up. And it's kind of the yeah, but. You know, I'd love to do that, but we don't have any money. Mm-hmm. I'd love to do that, but we don't have any money. And I know the concept, though, out there really is, how do you kind of redesign on a dime, that like HTTP type idea, because it doesn't have to be the top of the line brand name furniture and a multi-million dollar renovation that you all get that makes it all work.
Oh, yeah. We could spend $70 million in a minute if we had it, but we don't.
Right.
We don't have, you know, we don't even have $1 million in modernization funds in our capital improvement. So what we're doing is really looking at, what do we redirect? And one of the things that I've learned as a superintendent is that you've got to constantly be asking the question, how do I evaluate how we're spending our money and how could we redirect it and spend it differently? The other thing that I think is that people do, you look at sort of the wow environments, and there are some fabulous new environments out there that, you know, are just state of the art in terms of top end, comfortable, ergonomically great furniture. And we try to do some of that, but we see every one of those purchases as being very precious and offering us an opportunity to really learn something from when we put something that does cost a little more in. What do we do to evaluate the value of that compared to perhaps looking at things a little differently? But I think our makerspaces are a great example of that. Probably the question that we get asked most often, and we have been doing maker work probably as long as, if not longer than, just about anybody in the United States in schools. In fact, my earliest conversations with Dale Doherty, he didn't even believe that public schools could do maker work because of just the burden of testing and standards focus that it just permeated the country 6-7 years ago. But one of the things that I get asked all the time is, well, how much money is it going to cost me to build a makerspace? You know, and what are the things that I need to buy? How many 3D printers? How much of this? You know, do I need a laser cutter? What about this and that? And I say, you don't need anything except the cardboard that you're throwing out of your school as a starting point. You know, look at things that you can recycle, tools that are already in your school, and then very judiciously, as you figure out what kids want to be able to make, start to add to that. Now, if you're a school system that's flush with cash, I can give you the list of, you know, everything from soldering irons to glue guns to, you know, drills, cordless drills and laser cutters and so forth and so on. And we have all those things. But what we've tended to do is to build up based upon what kids have an interest and what teachers see kids having interest in doing in a maker space. And we have, you know, we have places that are still pretty much based in, you know, kids using whatever's available in the school already, and we have some places that have found that they want to go a little bit farther, and so we try to figure out how do we invest in what they need in the moment. And it is that writing process of you draft it and you revise it and you edit it, and eventually you get to a place where you say, okay, maybe we've pretty much got it right now, even though, you know, everybody knows that a year from now, there may be more tools that are different that we say we need. We also find that, oftentimes the things we need can be donated. You know, and this can be as true in an at-risk school as in one that's more affluent. We've had people, when we've put out the message that we need sewing machines, donate sewing machines. One of the most fun projects that I saw happen in Makerspace in the high school was the principal there is always known for wearing bow ties. So it's starting to get close to prom, and the boys realize that, you know, one of the things you wear at prom is a bow tie. And so rather than do the standard bow tie from whatever the store is where they rent their outfits, they decided they wanted to make their own bow ties. So the librarian gets the sewing machine into this place, and I walk in in there that are making bow ties from scratch to wear to prom. How cool is that? I mean, it's just kind of fun to see those things emerge. That's not in any curriculum, but I got to tell you, I have to believe that when kids go through that process of being able to make something like a bow tie, they're using math, they're communicating, they're having to work with an adult and figure out how to do something they never had an idea that they'd learn how to do, that there is something that gets built in that, whether you want to call it resilience or persistence, whether it's about their curiosity, whether it's about them staying with something that's of real interest to them, that there are all kinds of things that kids have the potential to learn in school that don't have anything to do with a standardized test. And for me, having those kids learn how to make a bow tie before school, at study hall, after school, whenever they show up in the library, add some value to their learning that wouldn't have existed before we started making some changes in these spaces. I've seen people, you know, we happen to live in a university community. At the end of the year, the kids at the university, they throw out things that, you know, many of our families would be happy to have. And so, you know, we try to figure out how do we scrounge from those things? How do we, you know, buy on the cheap, you know, and it could be bean bags or it could be you know, a variety of things that don't cost a lot, but do add some depth to a classroom environment. So there's you don't have to really look at this as being something that's a solution that demands a lot of money. In fact, sometimes having more money can actually be a detriment to the work that you want kids to do. And so, you know, we try to take what might be a lemon in terms of not having every dime that we want and turn it into the lemonade that we want by saying, what can kids make? I had a teacher in an academy who wanted wave tanks and realized the wave tanks were going to be too expensive. And as a result of having that sort of that maker mindset, what he did was, and what a great experience for the kids is, instead of just buying a tank from one of the big science equipment companies, he had the kids make their own wave tank. And I got to tell you, you know, when kids have finished a project like that and it really works and they can see water shooting up towards the ceiling from their use of that tank, you've done something that builds a sense of ownership for learning that's very different. So, you know, those are the kinds of things that we're out there doing is, you know, not trying to create cookie-cutter environments, not trying to create cookie-cutter teachers or even cookie-cutter kids, but to be able to say that when you take advantage of every aspect of space that you have at your fingertips, and that's everything from our kids, you know, being able to use walls and windows and floors to do design thinking work, to our kids being able to go out into the community and build bridges or figure out, you know, what they can give back to this community through in different spaces, more community-based spaces, I think that what you do is you end up with people who leave school that will have a very different mindset about learning and about who they are as community members, family members, and people that are going to work and continue to get educated over their careers and lives. It's going to feel very different than perhaps those of us that were educated in the 20th century.
Pam, we are winding down on time, and I could certainly listen to you talk all day on the incredible things you're doing in your district. But I want to hit just very quickly, few minutes or so, you know, all of this is really a teaching and learning conversation at the end of the day and how teaching and learning is shifting, but that comes along hand in hand with dynamic professional learning. So how are you starting to shift that to meet the needs of all of these changes? So it's not just an hours-based approach, top-down, you know, sit on a Thursday from 4 to 6 approach to people. So how is that shifting to make all of this work?
And just And I would certainly direct people to Edutopia just did a series of videos about Albemarle County, and we had a number of blogs that were posted at Edutopia. And one of the videos that was featured is about our instructional coaching model. So we have a team this year of ed tech specialists who are out in our schools that are really what we call digital learning integrators that are supporting teachers up around things that teachers want to learn to do. That could be Minecraft EDU, whether it's at the high school, middle school, or elementary level. It could be around how to use some of the new Google apps in more powerful ways with kids. It could be about construction kinds of things, using media capabilities of computers, variety of things. And then we have our instructional coaches who are more generalist, who work with teachers on the things teachers want to work on. So if a teacher says, I really want to deepen my capability to do real project-based learning with kids, our coaches are going to really work through that. They may be doing lesson study with teachers around something that an entire grade level or a team really wants to work on. Our professional learning community model we see as one of the developmentally best ways that teachers cross-pollinate. And it's not just about, doing the old style PLC of unpacking the data, but really thinking about, how is it that our kids, through their interactive technologies, through problem-based learning, project-based learning, through maker work, through the tools that we have around universal design for learning, how is it that we take strategies that we know that are effective strategies and we are able to really share those across teams of teachers and cross-pollinate? We run every fall a day of connectivity that has a bit of an ed camp flavor to it and a bit of a sort of a traditional conference workshopping flavor to it, where teachers come in and they basically offer sessions for each other on things that they're doing. And so it's teacher designed, teacher run sessions that are out there. The other thing that we really believe is that we do have to get teachers out of just sort of being in the teacher profession, the teaching profession. So we'll send people, we've had teachers go to Maker Faire as a team and experience what is it like to be in a world of makers who are not educators necessarily. We've had folks go to the Tinker Lab at the Chicago Children's Museum. We ask our people to study environments that are not traditional school environments and to notice what do people do in those environments that feels like learning, and to be able to bring that back into the mix. So we try to really break down what the traditional model of doing professional development and to look at it in a very different way. We have a number of principals that have flipped their faculty meetings, so you don't go in and get that traditional sort of principal talk and teachers listen, because as we said to our principals, if you don't want your teachers to do that in the classroom, why in the world would you do that to them in faculty meetings? So what they're really looking for is how do the teachers start to run those meetings and see those as professional opportunities to work together and to share, and then you use something like Google Docs if you've got some business items to put out there. So, I think it's just a real effort to do what we really say we want to do with our kids and to do it with our teachers as well, and that is to say we want to unleash the potential of everybody that is a learner in our system, whether it's adult or child. The last thing that I think is one of the more innovative professional learning pieces in Albemarle, and I see more people adopting this today, is that we really tried to figure out how could teachers' independent work, beyond the traditions of going to conferences, but teachers that participate routinely in, whether it's an Ed Chat, a Kinder Chat, a Virginia Chat, a SAT Chat, the connected, librarians, whatever it is that's out there, teachers who religiously are following blogs of some of the top educators in the country, and they're reading and interacting around math or whatever it is that's their passion. How do we give teachers credit for that? Because in the state of Virginia, you got to accrue so many points of professional development credit in a period of time. And we said, how can we have our effort to have our teachers value the connectivity of their kids? How do we value that for them as adult learners by giving them credit for taking advantage of the very powerful social media opportunities that are out there, webinars, things like this? If we had teachers watching this today, we'd say, let us know about it, and you can pick up some points for having sat in on this today. And, and that's a little different model than a lot of people who still believe that top-down learning is the way that adults learn best.
Yeah. So I'm going to ask you, as we're going to wrap up here, I'm going to ask you about what advice do you have to get started. But I do want to share a few examples that we have from a Future Ready end, or at least can reference. You were talking about professional learning, and one of the major gears of the Future Ready framework is that personalized professional learning. You were just really well describing in your district. Another one, though, is called the use of space and time. And it used to just be the use of time, but we felt so strongly that the spaces pieces we're discussing here today really needed to be integrated into that Future Ready framework. But one of our Future Ready partners, EdTech Team, does a lot. They've actually created a learning spaces design studio. If you know David Jakes from social media, he does a lot of work in this area, a lot of great work. And so I encourage our viewers to check out EdTech Team and the learning space design studio that they've got. Another one that's a little bit more specific to teachers is called Classroom Crit. If you've seen that one, at classroomcribs.com, where teachers submit their redesign in their classroom. You know, we're talking kind of at a leadership end, more of a global end here in this webinar, but, you know, for the average second grade teacher, what is it that they can do? And that Classroom Cribs really starts to get to the heart of that. We had a webinar on that about 6 or 8 months ago as well, and so a couple really good resources there to use. But turning back to you, Pam, to wrap this up in just a moment or two, what advice do you have for either a school leader or even, you know, even a teacher that's watching this? And starting to redesign their space, and why do it?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's fascinating. When Ira Sokol and I are doing work sometimes out at conferences or in webinars like this, we always leave people with this idea that you can make a change, and you can even make a change tomorrow. So you can make a change during one day that will make a difference for your kids. So what we do is we challenge people to really take the time to think about, after listening to all this, what's one thing that I could do tomorrow that would get me away from the dominant teaching wall, that gets my kids out of rows, that relaxes the environment so that kids have choices and that can find themselves be comfortable. You know, I have teachers that I've talked to that have had kids desk in rows for 20 years, and when we talk about just letting kids stand up when they feel like they need to stand versus sit, so they, you know, teachers have taken those old-style desks that are those four-legged desks and just raised them up so that kids can have standing desks. There are all kinds of simple things that you can do by just saying, I'm going to change one thing tomorrow. The other thing that I say to our leaders is that I had a mentor tell me when I was a young administrator this story. He said, Pam, one day you're going to have somebody come into the office and they're going to do something. They want to do something. And you're going to have a lot of questions about whether it's the right thing to do. And you're going to have two choices. You can either say yes or you can say no. And I can guarantee you one thing. If you tell a teacher who comes to you with an innovative idea that they believe will make a difference for kids, and you say to them no, not only will they not come back to you with that idea again, they will likely go tell at least 10 other teachers, don't even bother, because what you're going to get is no. So one of the things that I say to our administrators, and somebody wrote a book about this year later, that, you know, that I think it's called Get to Yes or something like that, is you've got to really look for opportunities to say yes. And even if you have to take a deep breath and work around it a little bit to try to make sure that you feel comfortable and safe, that you can get to yes, and that will make an incredible difference in your teachers being willing to take risks and then giving kids those chances. And the last example I'll leave you with, and it's one you asked me about, is that we brought a guy down to work in one of our middle schools that the kids and the principal were really interested in redesigning the dining experience in the cafeteria. And you know what middle school dining experience looks like. And so they were going to do some things. And so we brought Alex Gilliam, public workshop, out of Philadelphia down to work with these kids. I thought they were going to build a bunch of booths, maybe, or something like that. And all of a sudden, I get asked the question about, well, what we really don't want to do, the kids want to do, is they want to build tree houses. And I said, in the cafeteria? And they said, yeah, they want to build tree houses because they'd like to be able to eat, you know, to climb up and eat in the tree house, or, you know, to get under the tree house. And I said, well, how high are these tree houses going to be? Like maybe 6 or 7 feet? Well, yeah, maybe. I go down there, and they've got 12-foot high rolling tree houses in construction. And I just take this really deep breath, because, you know, the first thing that we always think about is liability. And I'm thinking, oh, my gosh. But then I start thinking about all the things kids do. Kids climb up really high on playground equipment outside of school. You know, there are all ways that do. I said, okay, we're going to have to get this inspected. We are definitely going to have to just check it out and make sure that it meets code. But I took a deep breath and I said, let's do this. And you know, those kids have had that now for months and months and months. They're totally safe. They built routines with the kids, you know, of how it was going to get used and what was safe. And the kids love it, and it has changed the way that, things work in that cafeteria. I could have said no at the beginning of, no, we don't need to do anything in our cafeteria. It's just fine. You got tables just like everybody else does. I could have said no to the treehouse at any point, but what I did was I said yes. And I think that every time we do that and we learn that you can take small risks and that things are going to be okay, it causes us to realize that we've become such a risk-averse society that we forget that the world got here by people taking risks and the inventions that we have. We wouldn't have people that had landed on the moon if we didn't have people that took risks. And if we can't restore some of that back into our schools by getting to yes, then likely we will never be able to change schools from the places they were in the 20th century to what they need to be for our contemporary learners today. And I quite frankly believe that if we don't make those changes, that we are going to really fail our kids as we see a very different world evolve over this next 20 to 30 years. So I would just end it with that.
Wow, Pam, so well said, and thank you for that. I want to remind our viewers that information on Future Ready effort can be found at futurereadyschools.org. We encourage and challenge district superintendents to sign the Future Ready District Pledge, just like Pam has done, and for districts to take advantage of our incredible resources, including the Future Ready Schools Interactive Dashboard, which is a systemic planning tool. I want to thank Pam, as well as thank you, our viewers, for joining us for this Future Ready webinar. Don't forget to connect with us here at Future Ready on Twitter, at Future Ready, and on Facebook, at facebook.com/futurereadyschools. If you missed any of today's conversation, it will be archived at allfored.org/webinars immediately following this webinar. You can also find all of the Alliance's Google Hangouts on our YouTube channel as well. For those of you taking part in the Action Academy badging platform, the password for today's webinar is space. Thanks again, Pam. Thanks, our viewers.
Thank you. Thanks, Tom.